So when I got hurt, I was still getting calls and they was asking me what was my recovery time, and I didn't know.
Today on the show, we have former NBA and college hooper with the 97 Elite Eight Louisville Cardinals, Alvin Sims, is up next. Hello, everyone, and welcome back to the show. Today's guest was a member of the 1997 Louisville Cardinal men's basketball team that stormed through the 1997 NCAA tournament all the way to the Elite Eight. He's a former NBA player with the Phoenix Suns as well as professionally overseas. Welcome to the show, Mr. Alvin Sims.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. Appreciate it.
Oh, man, Al, man, thank you so much, man. I know we've been trying to get together a few weeks ago, maybe even a month ago or so, but I really appreciate your time, man, coming to spend with us, man. Just so you know, everybody, Memphis and Louisville are big rivals, man, but off the floor, we're just
right.
One big basketball family. Honestly, this is the first time we've actually had a conversation, Al, but we kind of know each other, you know what I mean? Know each other from playing, kind of play similar, you know, play above the rim and things like that. So even without saying, you know, you can communicate and just know each other and just have that mutual respect for one another. And I, like I said, I appreciate you being on the show today, man.
I appreciate it too, man. Thank you.
Absolutely. So before we get into our conversation with Alvin, we want to give a huge shout out to another loyal listener, former Tiger basketball player Todd Munt. He reached out to us to say how much he is enjoying all these amazing stories. And a little breaking news is he's going to be on a future episode of the Fifth Quarter Podcast. Now let's get back into our conversation with Alvin Sims.
All right, before we get started, I want to give a couple of shout outs too, Sandy. Sorry.
Okay.
It's just three loyal listeners that I really want to get. I don't want to do everybody because I'll forget, but these three are really, really been in our corner. Megan Ambrosi, I used to coach her daughter and her son, really good players. Mr. Jarvis Price in Memphis, he's been down with us from day one. I know you know him. And Mr. Troy Sarge Pennington, he lives in North Carolina. He used to play with the opposing team, the Washington Generals, but really good guy, really good close friend of mine. We've been friends for a few decades. So I just want to give a shout out to those three and say what's up.
Absolutely. Okay, so Mike, I'm just going to let you kick it off then.
Also, Al, what you doing now? Tell us about yourself. What you been doing after, you know, after college? What happened?
So after college, I pursued a professional basketball career. After that, you know, I was stuck because I got hurt my last season in 2009. Broke my foot. So after that, I went back to school, got my education. Then I got in the school system. I also had four kids, so I wanted to make sure they had a pathway to success. So invested all my time with them in sports, mainly basketball, trained them. Then other people saw me training my kids, and they, you know, I just went from there. I started training kids, and then I ended up coaching. So right now I'm coaching like four travel teams. I coach girls volleyball. I coach girls, middle school girls basketball, boys basketball. I coach track. So I'm out there, man.
I like I said, I know you're really busy, man, in coaching and things like that. After, you know what this podcast is about. Fifth Quarter podcast is really about your life after the game. You know, a lot of us are not prepared. A lot of us think we're prepared. A lot of us like, okay, what we're going to do now. So we're going to get into a little bit of that. But first, Iowa. You're in Iowa right now, right?
Yeah.
Are you from Iowa? Well, how did you get to Iowa?
No, he's not from
I'm from Kentucky. But so when I played for the Quad City Thunder, which is in a part of Iowa, it's on the border of Illinois and Iowa on the Mississippi River. I had kids here, so basically I ended up coming back to raise them. So that's how I got here and stayed here. Even though my kids are not here anymore, I'm still here.
That's kind of like my brother went into the Air Force and ended up in Omaha, Nebraska. And had kids there, and he's still there too, but so are his kids. But I was still beautiful. Are you close to the Field of Dreams field?
No, but I've been there.
You have?
That's deep in the country.
Yes, it is. It is. deep in those cornfields of Iowa.
Yeah. I have a brother-in-law and his wife. They are actually in Iowa. They teach at University of Iowa.
Okay.
In Ames, I think, right? I don't know how far you are from there, but that's where they are.
That's actually Iowa State, Ames. Yeah.
He lives in Ames, but he
teaches in Iowa City. Yeah.
Yes. So, man. Yeah.
So let's run it back, because we're going to come back to your fifth quarter and the injury and all that. But let's run it back to you said you're from Kentucky, and like, where at in Kentucky did you grow up?
I grew up in a small town called Paris, Kentucky. Mm-hmm. It's where all the horse farms are, mm-hmm. Surrounding Paris. I went to Paris High School, and that's where it all started as far as sports for me.
How close to the Tennessee border is that?
I want to say maybe 3 hours, three and a half hours.
Okay. I'm from McKenzie, Tennessee, which is right. We're about, I guess, an hour from the Kentucky border also.
Yeah. Well, he claims Memphis.
I do claim Memphis. I do. Although I'm going to piss everybody off that I grew up with. So you grew up in Kentucky and you grew up in Paris, and Mike always likes to ask this question, but I'm going to ask it. So when did you start playing basketball?
Organized basketball started at 9 to 10 years old.
Did you like it?
I was good at it. It was my first year out of playing. But
that wasn't my question. My question was, did you like it?
I liked all sports at that age.
Okay.
Yeah.
When did you find out, man, you had an athlete? Because you were very gifted athletically. When did you know, like, oh, wow, I can run faster than this guy. I can jump higher than this guy. I can do that. And, like, Sandy said, when did you really fall in love with it? That's a two-part question.
I probably didn't fall in love with it till I want to say sophomore year in high school. I've learned I was very gifted as far as athletic, grade school. We used to have, the relay races,
right.
You get your ribbons and, the athletic scholastic stuff we had to do in PE, running a mile, push-up, pull-ups, all that stuff. But sophomore year, I played on the Kentucky All-Star, junior All-Star team. We traveled, to Vegas, L.A., and played. It was, the AAU before AAU. And we played in the Pepsi tournament, the Nike Invitational in Vegas. And that's when I saw all these, high level basketball players. And I'm like, man, I can play with the best of them. And after that, I started trying to perfect my craft and everything else. So at that point in time, that's when I fell in love with basketball.
I have a couple of teammates that are from Kentucky. I know it's spread out, but Otis Key, he played, he's from Russellville.
Okay.
And Charles Webb, they call him Bubba Wells. He played, he's from Kentucky. You know those guys?
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good bunch of guys. We had Otis on the show about a month or so ago. He was one of the three Trotters that we had on the show, Sandy. So they are from. And Paul Gaffney. Paul Gaffney is one too. He's from Kentucky as well. Mm-hmm. He claims Kentucky as well. So you played for the great Denny Crum, man, didn't you? You had a chance to play. Did you play for him your whole time? Or
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What did he think? I know it was a rivalry. You were from Louisville, because I remember back in 95 when we played you guys. See, everybody on our team was from Memphis, so we knew what the rivalry was about. But I don't think everybody on your team kind of knew what the rivalry was about. And I'm sure you're like, hey, man, this is real. I mean, what? Did they even have any idea? But I know Coach Crum did.
No. Like I said, I'm from Paris, which is 15 miles from Lexington, Kentucky. Right. Yeah. Right. University of Kentucky. So that was that was the focus focal point for me as far as rivalry. But, you know, after a couple of years, yeah, Memphis became the second rivalry for me.
Just a little bit before your time, man, when it was Memphis State and, you know, and things like that. But when Milt Wagner were playing and Kenny Payne and those guys were playing, it was a huge rival, man. It was a huge rival. And we didn't play you guys for years. And so when we got a chance to play you guys in a tournament, we were really, really hype about it. We were really fired up about it. I don't talk to Samaki, but I got this picture, man, where I'm blocking Samaki's shot, man. So I'm actually catching his shot out the air. And I give him crap for it every now and again, man. But he doesn't respond to it. But it's all right. Tell him I said it's okay.
All right. It's all good. So I want to ask about, when did you start getting recruited by colleges in high school?
After that stint in LA and Vegas,
right.
I couldn't even tell you, a boatload of letters started coming in.
Did that freak you out? Were you like, oh my God?
I wasn't knowledgeable about the recruiting process at that point in time. You know, my mom's single parent, she didn't really know either. I had, you know, my high school coach, he didn't have an athlete that was highly recruited as I was at that point in time. So it was like, you know, something new for him as well. Sure. But yeah, I enjoyed the letters. I opened up to every one of them. I read every one of them. I saved them. I had so the tall dresser drawer, my whole dresser drawer is full of letters.
Oh my God.
You still got them today?
Nah, I don't know. They're somewhere. I don't know.
why did
you choose Louisville?
Yeah. Why Louisville?
Well, it was a big issue as far as my recruitment. Morehead State, like all the local colleges were heavily recruiting me. So what happened was Morehead State actually put that I verbally committed to them, which wasn't, they had that in a magazine. So a lot of the colleges that were recruiting me, like, backed off.
Sure.
So I had to restart the process. And after I restarted the process, I restarted the process and went to the Kentucky. I made the Kentucky All-Stars. It was like the summer of my senior year.
Right.
So Denny and they were recruiting me as well. Xavier was heavy on me at that time. USC, George Raveling, Arizona State, Temple. I had a lot of, you know, interest in them too. But my family were big Louisville fans. So
really?
My uncle, yeah, he had the game on all the time. I started watching with him. And he also liked big guards. So I wanted to be a big guard. I liked the way he utilizes guards. And, you know, I thought Louisville would be a good fit for me. So,
You were. How tall are you, Al? I know you're a big guy. How tall are you?
6'4".
Yeah, you're about I'm about 6'5", maybe an inch taller. But, our game is similar, man. You are a high flyer, man. And I remember a lot of your highlights. I used to watch you guys a lot. How was it playing for Coach Crum? We growing up, man, because I just liked basketball. I was actually recruited by Louisville when Coach Houston was there.
Yeah.
Coach Houston, and he got the job at Tennessee, and they backed off, and Tennessee started recruiting me, man. So we have similar. We could have been on the same path, probably been on the same team. That would have been something to see, wouldn't it? Me and you on the same team.
Been alive, would have been open all day.
Exactly. How was it playing for Coach Prime, man? He seemed like his demeanor was cool. I never saw him, like, get bent out of shape or anything like that. Or is it just for the cameras? I don't know.
Like Rick Pitino?
Yeah, he probably didn't get caught on camera. But, yeah, Denny Crum was very competitive. So, you know, his temperament as far as being successful was, like, It could happen at any point in time. You make a mistake, he's he's frustrated because he's the type that, you know, he wants you to be prepared for the games. He prepares you well for games. So if you make a mistake with Denny, he's going to drill you about it. And then, you know, he's going to go over it with you, make sure you don't make that same mistake again.
Was there any culture shock going from Paris to Louisville? Was there a culture shock in leaving home and having to go, even though you're in the same state?
No, like I said, as a sophomore, we were traveling everywhere, you know, going out west and everything. And plus, I used to live in Sacramento at a young age. Mm-hmm. I lived, you know, I was actually born in Evanston, Illinois. So, and then from there, I migrated to Kentucky. So now I was used to moving around.
Okay.
Oh, man, this is such a small world, man. You said Evanston, Illinois. The guy used to own the Globetrotters. His name is Manny Jackson. He's from Evanston, Illinois, man. It's such a small world.
Yeah.
I told Sandy before, out of all my places and all the times I played basketball, the NCAA tournament, man, is where it was. That was my favorite time playing, man, because everybody's in their A game. You were peaking, man. It was something special. How was that experience for you?
It was, you know, Conference USA and the Metro, really, it was just like the NCAAs every game.
It was.
Super.
I want to run it back for just a second. I forgot to ask this. When you were in high school and you were being recruited and you started college, what were your aspirations then? Were you only thinking the NBA or were you even thinking the NBA?
I wasn't even thinking the NBA. I was just wanted to be in college. You know, it was one of, you know, I just wanted to graduate college. I didn't really think about playing professional. My grandmother always wanted me to get educated. So that was one of my goals. I guess after my sophomore year in college, that's when, you know, I got a lot of attention. I started to get attention, and then basketball did become number one over education at that time. So I actually like switched majors and everything. So to lighten the load as far as, you know, being academically eligible and being able to focus on both. So
what was your first degree that you, your first major?
Well, I wanted to be a commercial artist.
Really?
Yeah. It was kind of, you know, it took a lot of time. You had to take courses during the night and stuff like that. So it kind of didn't work out for me. So I had to switch up. I went into sports administration.
So the commercial art, because I find this fascinating, because that's an unusual answer we've had before. But the commercial artist, like, what did you want to do with that specifically?
I wanted to like use my, I was really a great artist in high school. I did like murals of Martin Luther King, Michael Jordan, all the sports figures. And they were like poster size when I used to do it. So it took me like at least a week to finish each one of them. So I took my time with that. I wanted to have a website and display those and eventually like sell my art.
Was it painting or was it drawing?
Pastels.
Interesting. Oh,
wow. You know, my son is taking that route. My son attends the School of Arts here in D.C. called Duke Ellington, and he's into that. He's doing his senior project right now. He has this big canvas, man. He won't tell us what he's doing, but he's painting this big canvas. Do you ever think about getting back into it? You know, it's not too late. You know, it's,
Do you still dabble in the pastels or any other types of art?
Nah, that was a long time ago. But I'm just so into like developing kids. That's my art right now.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll talk to we had a former Georgetown Hoyer on a few weeks ago, Jerome Williams, and he was talking about how we have the blueprint and what it takes. You know, I always tell this story about my kids were in swimming and it was this big organization and they had like 50 kids in the pool, man. And at a young age, and it was no correcting, no stopping and going. It was just like next, like an assembly line. So I took them out and put them in a smaller group because talk about how important skill development is at that age. Because as a coach, I know if you coach the young players, you leave practice more tired than they are because of you're mentally tired. You're stopping and you're starting and have to explain. And I tell people how important it is because at a young age, you develop so many bad habits.
Right. Yeah. So, yeah, I drill them just like I mentioned earlier, Denny Crum. You know, you make that mistake, he's going to stop practicing. He's going to correct that mistake so you be prepared for games. So that's my philosophy as well. You know, just having them look at, you know, various situations that's going to come about when they're in competition. You know, just like the proper passes, you know, especially when we're going over plays or even when we're doing drills, like dribbling drills. You know, I just remind them, keep the ball at your waist, protect the ball, stay low, eyes up, all that stuff. So, and it's just, you know, you have to drill that into them in order for them to be able to play at the next level, whether it be for another coach in high school or at least try to get to the collegiate level.
Hey, coach, I know they know my when I was coaching, all my kids, they asked the same question. I'm sure they asked you the same question. Coach, can you still dunk for us? Can you still dunk? How often does that happen?
All the time. I said, hey, man, I can barely walk.
So let's talk about that run to the Elite Eight. Were you a senior in college at that time?
I was a senior. Mm-hmm.
Okay. What was that like? Obviously, you get through the first. So what was it like when you found out you guys were playing in the tournament?
We were used to playing in the tournament like every year. But, you know, we've always been stuck at the Sweet 16.
Right.
Then following the last year, we wanted to at least break that and go to the next round. We had a lot of obstacles the previous 2 years. You know, losing Samaki, losing Jason Osborne. We lost a lot of key players. So we had to rebuild and reconstruct our strategies and everything. So we had, you know, Alex Sanders fill in.
That's my teammate, man. We played together for about 8 years.
Yeah. Damian Dantzler, he was a younger player. Tony Williams, you know, DeJuan got hurt during the tournament, so we had to make a lot of things. Yep.
Oh, man, if he wouldn't have got hurt, y'all really would have did some damage.
What was the name?
DeJuan Wheat.
Okay.
Yeah. Y'all, yeah, he was a monster. Hey, I think Cameron used to play for you guys too, right? Yeah. Cameron Murray.
Right. He was a redshirt my senior year.
Okay.
So, yeah, he practiced with us and everything. So, I wish we had him, too. So, he was a great passer.
So, yeah. you get to the Elite Eight, and you were already starting to get a whole lot of notice, you said. So, were you getting more and more input or getting more and more looks from NBA scouts?
Yeah. When we played Texas in the Sweet 16, I had a explosive game. I scored like 25 points. Had like two or three posters that game. And we were in front of like 60,000. So, yeah, it was a lot. I got a lot of attention then after that. And I locked down Reggie Freeman, who was like one of the leading scorers in the nation. He only had 6 points that game.
Wow.
And, you know, being – they noticed me as a two-way player, explosive, can guard anybody. So, yeah, I got a lot of attention. Agents start, you know, lurking around. They was already setting up the exposure camps for me and stuff like that.
You know, it's funny. I don't like that term two-way player, man. Back when we were playing, you know, you just, and as athletic as you were, you one of the few players that use your athletic ability on both ends. It was like, man, there's no way I'm going to be this athletic and I'm going to let some guy score on me. Right. You know what I mean? So it's rare that you get that nowadays. Most people focus on offense, but I just don't like that word two-way player, man, because to me, if I'm playing hard defense and somebody scores on me, I take it as an insult.
Yeah.
You know, players today, they don't do that, man. So, I mean, after college, I mean, you know, you came out in 97, right?
Yeah.
After college, what's up? Because 96, I always still, 96 was a great draft. Arguably, probably the greatest draft ever. And I'm sure Samaki will agree with that. That 96 draft was a monster. Yeah. So you came out in 97.
Yeah, I was pushed to, I had a lot of people come to me and told me to leave when Samaki left, but I wanted to play my senior year. So 97. So after the tournament, we lost in the Elite Eight against North Carolina. So after that, played in the college All-Star game.
Right.
I was in that, at dunk contest. I won the college all-star dunk contest, but I felt like I got cheated in that other, like, college celebrity dunk contest, because we had Bob Huggins and what's the guy, Boozer from
yeah.
So they didn't like me because I posted them, so they didn't give me good scores. But after that, started training, man, for the NBA. I was, they was predicting me late first round, early second. So I, at that time, I'm like, okay, I'm gonna get drafted. So I didn't get drafted. San Antonio, they said they would have drafted me, but they only had one pick, and that was for Tim.
Right.
Houston, they said they were going to draft me, but they ended up drafting Roderick Rhodes instead of me. Let's see. Seattle, Cleveland, New York. New York said if they didn't get a big man, they would come after me, but that didn't happen. So I ended up not getting drafted. Second round, they started trading picks, or eventually, like, they were drafting Europeans that didn't even come over here.
So
what was your mindset like going through that process? Because it, at least with the NBA, you have it, what, in one night or in one day?
Mm-hmm.
With the NFL, it's like 15 weeks or something. I'm joking. But, like, what was that thought process going through each one of those picks and you not being picked?
And knowing you were better than some of those players.
Yeah, I was devastated. I was devastated. You know, I kind of just went into hiding. So, and then also, you know, I was getting calls for Summer League, LA, Atlanta. All these teams started calling me after the draft, come play in our Summer Leagues. So it was so many teams. And then, you know, I ended up picking LA to go play out there with Kobe and can't even remember his name, Derek Fisher. They was second year out of, you know, they was second year from playing in the NBA. So I ended up playing with them. And it was a good experience. I also played in Atlanta for like maybe 3 or 4 weeks, maybe less than that. Before I went to LA, they were upset that I didn't stay, but I already committed to LA, so I went out there and played in the summer league with Kobe.
So how was that playing with Kobe?
It was a disaster.
Oh, let us know about this. What's up?
So Kobe was a star. I mean, you know,
how old was he at that time?
You gotta say pretty much the same position.
Yeah, yeah. So he was a star out there as far as the summer league. It was his summer league. So he took a lot of shots, man. Just basically, I'm running them down the court with my hand. I'm
open. Suicide, huh?
Yeah. So it was crazy because back then it was at Long Beach State. They had like 13,000 seats in their arena. Everybody had the digital cameras back then.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
So it wasn't cell phones. So every time Kobe made a move, you see all these flashes.
Oh, my gosh.
It was insane. So... But there was a bright spot for me. We played against Portland, with they brought their whole roster. So instead of, you know, playing regular summer league, it was like playing a regular NBA game.
Oh my gosh.
So Kobe was going all out. He shot like 38 times and only scored 30. So
Wow, he said 30th.
Got benched the second. The next day, we played against Dallas, and then I got my shot. I scored like 29 against Samaki, so it was fun for me.
What's good?
Wow, 30 shots, man. That's hard to swallow. I don't think I've ever taken that many shots in a game.
So what do you think your biggest lesson you learned from that summer experience?
You just got to be in the right position at the right time. You just got, I know, like, Bubba Wells was there, too, when we played Dallas. So, yeah, he was, like, in the same predicament as far as trying to get his name out there and everything. But, yeah, you just had to be on the right team at the right time.
All right, so after that, I mean, what was your path after that? Did you say that, okay, I'm going to Europe, or
so the CBA had their draft, so I got drafted by the Quad City Thunder. I also had options to go overseas, but I felt like I'm right there. I can crack in, I can get my shot. So I went to the CBA. I started working hard, like every day, working on my conditioning, working on my jump shot, handles, everything, trying to play all the positions, really, working on post games, doing everything. So ended up getting Rookie of the Year. I thought I was going to get a couple call-ups, but they said no. So I never got called up my rookie season. So after that, I went overseas. I played in Greece. I was like top three in scoring, steals. So I had a great career my first year in Greece. Well, I can go back. I had a great career in the CBA as well. We won the championship that year, my rookie year. And then, the following year, I went to Greece. We made it to the final four of the Courage Cup. We got beat by Barcelona. They really outmanned us. We had a young team, so I don't think anybody was over 23 at that time. But we did well.
Wow! Did you like Europe? Because I love certain places. Certain places that was okay, but I liked Greece. I'm sure you played in a lot of different places. What was your favorite place?
Greece was my favorite place. It had everything, man. I mean, I lived in Athens and Macedonia coast, where the food was always good. The weather was always nice.
Did you get a chance to go on the Acropolis?
Yeah, I went there. Yeah, it was.
I remember being like really hot there, man. It was so hot, man. Dogs were like in the airport, laying on the floor, trying to keep cool. It was so warm over there.
Mm-hmm. So after you played a year in Greece, and then Phoenix called you. Is that correct?
Yep. So it was the 99 lockout year. After the CBA, I got Rookie of the Year. Phoenix was like, they were very interested, but the lockout happened. So, yeah, I went to Greece. I played over there. They were still interested. So after our playoffs, I went from Greece directly to the Phoenix Suns.
So that was a high for you. That was an excitement that you're getting right to come back to the States, or getting to go to an NBA team. And what was that whole process like on the team playing with them?
Well, I was coming in towards the end of the season, so I was brand new to everybody. They really didn't know me. They didn't know my game, other than the coaches. Toby Baylor was there. He knew how I played. I loved to play with Phoenix, but it was kind of difficult because, I was still trying to find my way. Mm-hmm. They had me at point guard, so that was kind of new for me. I was just out there as a true rookie. So I made a couple mistakes, but I had a few highlights as well.
So you were like a tweener, man. So you were 6'4", but you know, you usually, you know, now, you know, growing up, you know, we like, okay, you're going to be the point guard, but you were 6'4" and athletic. You know, that's what I found out. You know, me being 6'5" and athletic, it's just different, man. Everybody there is so much bigger than the average person. You know, I remember playing with them and it was like, Mike, you point guard. And I've never played point guard before. I'm like, what? Because I couldn't hold nobody else. Everybody else was so much bigger than I was. Who you were going to hold? So I know there was a difficult transition for you.
Well, you know, and not only that, I don't think that people truly realize, if unless you've been in that position, you're given this opportunity, but you've constantly have to be under stress that you have to perform well. You have to keep performing well to stay on the team. And there's always people coming behind you that want your spot.
Yep.
So that has to be an amazing amount of mental stress on you.
Yeah, it was. I mean, every day, especially in the NBA, you know, things could happen just like that. You can get traded, you can get cut, you get waived. And not even know why. So, right. Yeah, it's very stressful.
And they don't even have to tell you why, do they? No. They don't even have to tell you. Somebody else can tell you. So then you went back overseas for quite a few years. You were there you went to Quad City Thunder again for a year. And then you went back overseas. I'm curious because one of the countries that it says you played in two of them was Lebanon and Iran. And so... Yeah. I'm curious about the Iran. How long were you in Iran?
I was there 4.5 months.
What year?
I think it was 2000.
Because I have a history background. That's why I'm asking this.
I think it was 2007. No, 2000.
What was the name? 2000. Was it the Sagiz? Beirut? That was Beirut. Yeah, that was Lebanon.
Yeah, so... Iran, it was Petrushimi. It was on the border of Iraq. So our team actually stayed like in a compound. So I was living like in a dormitory. And, you know, we had cafeteria, all that stuff. You couldn't even spend like $200 in that place a month. It was, you know, everything was so cheap. The living where I was, it was very good. Other places in Iran, they didn't even have toilets. So
yeah. Did you have a lot of the locals come to your games?
Yeah, it was packed. Yeah. They love sports over there. Every team had their own fans, just like everywhere else in Europe. Right. Especially, they had volleyball was very popular in Iran. So. Yeah, it was. I liked it there. Actually, the competition was steep. So,
what about Lebanon? When were you in Lebanon? Because I was in Lebanon. We played. Actually, we were playing against teams in Lebanon. I don't know if you were there or not. But we played against like every quarter. We played four quarters, and every quarter we played against a different team from Lebanon.
So 2005 through 2000. I have your list up. 2005 through 2007.
Yeah, Lebanon was real fun. I loved it because, you know, you didn't have to travel very, you know, far to play. So every game was easy.
Were y'all living in Beirut?
Yeah, I lived in Beirut. I lived on a resort. So I had the beach, swimming pool, all that. And I had a king suite. So, and I had all my food catered. They had, you know, a lot of good food in Lebanon.
I think
you probably stayed at the same place I did. I remember a place like that when we stayed in Lebanon. It was nice. It was very nice. We were only there for about maybe a week, but I knew security was very tight there. It was really tight. And we never drove down the same, we never drove to the arena the same way, or never went back to the hotel the same way. We always went down different ways. I don't know what was it like there, like that for you, as far as living day to day.
I had my own car, so I was, you know, I just went where I actually every day with my routine. So if I had to go to the grocery store, I went there. I really didn't go out there because, you know, the bombings and stuff that happened periodically. So. Yeah, I just stayed to myself pretty much.
Did you have any family with you over there, or were you just completely by yourself?
Nah, I was by myself in Lebanon. Iran wouldn't let you have anybody with you, so.
So mentally, you know, Michael's talked about, you know, especially before social media got really big, that you get to know yourself pretty well.
Yeah. I started becoming like avid Bible reader. I read a lot of Bible verses. When I was in Iran, they tried to, they wanted me to become a Muslim, but
yeah.
They do have Christians in Iran, I was just into having my own personal relationship. So I wasn't trying to get involved in one side or the other.
Right.
So I want to talk about real quick, Sandy. I want to talk about the fifth quarter. What is it about? You know, fifth quarter meaning your life after the game. You know what I mean? Like, what are you going to do? And some people, you know, a lot of athletes, most of them, they have a hard time adjusting to life outside of the game. They're not prepared. They think they're prepared or whatever reason may be. So I know you said earlier you were hurt. When did your fifth quarter pretty much start for you?
Man, so I guess it might have took me three or 4 years after, you know, because I always thought, you know, I can get back out there. But being, I was 36, so I was, you know, I thought I could play till like I was 50. The way at that point in time, I was still in great shape. So when I got hurt, I was still getting calls and they was asking me what was my recovery time. And I didn't know. So at that point in time, it ended up after a whole year, they stopped calling. So then I was like, well, it's time to move on. So I did have a hard time. I didn't know what I wanted to do. So school was number one. Then, I got into the educational system. I wanted to be a high school coach. So, I mean, you know, I was assistant coach for high school, plenty, like my old high school and a couple other schools in Kentucky. And, I was just looking for my shot. And then at that point in time, I got turned down by my own high school as far as being a head coach. So I was like,
oh my gosh.
I was like,
it happens. Wow. It happens to the best of us. I want to go back to, I want to just dig a little deeper. Okay. When did you realize like, okay, I know it's over. You know, I know you said they stopped calling. And how did you feel? Did you have a support system? I mean, what was going through your head? Were you afraid? You got to think, you're 36. You're 36. You wasn't 26. You're 36. And a lot of people, our friends that didn't play ball, they're in their career. They were talking about, man, I got about 5 more years. I'm retired and stuff like that. And you're 36. And you're like, okay, what am I going to do now? Were you afraid? I mean.
Yeah, I was super afraid. So at that point in time, the money wasn't coming in like it used to be. I had depleted most of my savings. When the stock market happened, the crash, I lost a lot of money in investments. So yeah, I had to start grinding. I started selling cars. I got into sales. I was selling lawn care. I worked for True Green. You know, things happened, and I was like, man, I've hit rock bottom. I don't know what to do next. So. I was just didn't know what to do. I was depressed. I was just trying to jump in wherever I could. I even reached out to all my NBA buddies. You know, y'all need any NBA scouts. Right. Scouting was limited at that point in time. I almost went overseas and started coaching, but yeah, it was just, I was everywhere, mentally everywhere.
So how did you keep the motivation going every single day?
I started like playing pickup every morning, for you know, exercising for my mental health. Started, you know, running. I was running hills. I was, you know, anything. This, you know, to stay. When you're an athlete, you're always an athlete. You, I was still grinding, like I was going to play to get invited to a camp or something. I was just out there, still felt like I had it. I played against everybody, anywhere, every day. So that helped me get through everything day by day. And then when I started to get even older, and you know, the arthritis started setting in and everything. So I kind of slowed down, but, you know, just when I got into training and coaching and being with my kids, that really helped me.
Oh, wow. So when you were going through this, Sandy usually asks this, what was your support system like? Or was it just you?
It was just me. Just me. I didn't have a support system. Even at, you know, University of Louisville, I was asking them, what can I, you know, can I get on the staff? You know, can I come train people down there? You know, Rick Pitino took over. Right. So it wasn't Denny anymore. So I was like out of the circle. So even though I went down there to visit, it didn't even feel like, you know, that's where I was an alumni from. So.
You know, I think that's really true as coaches move on and administration moves on. When the older players, former players come back, it's not the same. The building may be the same, but the people are different and they don't always remember you.
Right.
Well, I'll say this. I think it depends on the coach. I really think it depends on the coach, because if you're there, you're supposed to be part of a fraternity. You're supposed to be part of all the story programs. If you look down their benches, all you see is former players. You know, you former players. And, you know, my sons, they didn't play basketball, but they are swimmers. My youngest son is a swimmer. And it means something to me. If we go on visits, I'm going to look and see how many former players they got on their staff or how they take care of their players. I think that means something. I know it's a bitter taste because the way he left Memphis and now he's at Kentucky, but I have to say this. I have to give him his props. Coach Cal, he did his thing. He made us feel welcome when he was at Memphis, big time, like really big time. I'm sure that was a devastating for you. You know, you gave everything you could to Louisville and things like that, and it came back to like, okay, what have you done for us lately? You can't help us now, so we can't help you. So, I mean, what were you feeling? Did you feel betrayed?
Yeah, I definitely felt betrayed. I felt like nobody, you know, wanted to extend their hand so I can, you know, at least get my foot in the door somewhere. I didn't care at that time. I didn't care if I was security. You know, I would love to be a part of the university as security.
Right.
But nobody extended a hand. It was, I felt betrayed.
So, what's the end game? Do you want to get back? Do you think you want to coach college or get back? Would you ever reach back out? And how's your relationship with Louisville now?
It's better. We have Kenny Payne. Kenny Payne's there. Milt, all the old players are there. So it's way better. The communication is better. We get texts about dinners, alumni dinners. You know, they give us tickets now in the games. I used to have the contact Kenny Payne, who was over the media, just to get tickets. It was, you know, because I couldn't get them from Rick. So at that point in time, so Kenny Klein used to help me out and give me tickets and stuff like that. But it's way better now.
That's awesome, man. I'm glad that relationship. We had Tony Harris on the show, and he said his relationship had soured, right, Sandy? And with Tennessee, but now it's getting back. I think with time, man, anything can heal, man. And you know,
and also the change in administrations, the change in coaches, the change in culture. What was there any specific thing that really kind of pushed you into, or was the turning point for you to get into like where you are now? Because it's a day, you talked about it's a daily grind, and you're just trying to reach out to all these people and try to make money every day. So was there Was that just a gradual thing, or was there like one turning point where, okay, I can see the light now. I can see the path I'm going really well.
Well, I had others help me. My current girlfriend, she helped me get into the school system that I am actually in now. So I kept moving up the ladder. So now I'm a behavioral specialist. So I have an actual career. I feel confident in my career. And then I also have room to grow. I can end up being a director of the school. So I'm in administration right now. So I've worked my way up to this point. And also, you know, being in the community, a lot of people, they respect me, but, you know, and they want me all over the place. That's why I coach so many teams.
Right.
But, you know, I realize I'm only one person. So my time is limited with that. But I'm satisfied with my life right now.
That's good, man. I saw your demeanor kind of pepped up when Sandy asked you that question.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you seem like, like it feels good to get back at it and receive your flowers and be able to pass your gift along, because basketball has been so great for both of us.
Yeah.
You know, and it took us so many places. It took you around the world.
Yeah.
You know, you think a little kid from Kentucky would have been playing in Lebanon in Greece and places like that. You never thought you'd be in places.
I'm jealous. I would love to have been in those countries. what do you think your biggest value is to others now?
Life experience. I can pass on a lot of knowledge to others, you know, from my trials and tribulations. I can tell them what to do, what not to do, how to prepare, you know, like I've done for my own children.
Right.
My own children have a lot of success. My oldest daughter played at Tennessee State basketball. She has a master's in social work. My son graduated from Midway University. He's he has a career now, corporate Pepsi, Coca-Cola, whatever.
Two different brands there.
Yeah, better get it right. Yeah.
Coca-Cola, sorry.
Just trying to keep you from getting in trouble after the thing's over.
My middle daughter, she's at Lenore Ryan in North Carolina. She's the second sophomore year playing basketball there. My youngest is at Northern Kentucky University. It's her first year. She's going to run track. So, I mean, I prepared. You help prepare all my children to be successful. I'm a proud dad.
I see, man. That's beautiful.
It is
just
beautiful.
So you know, Al, it's just not basketball players. I think Sandy can go in. Sandy, if you would like to, I really would like to let him know that it's just not basketball players. Tell him what you doing, not just the podcast, but tell him what you were doing in Houston and stuff like that. Yeah.
So, you know, Michael and I, we obviously have the Memphis basketball connection, but I do brand and career strategy. And I've spent the past 5 years, I was working for a nonprofit out of Houston, teaching professionals from regular bachelor's degrees to PhDs. They were from the ages of 30 to 65. And it's not just athletes. Anyone who loses a job for whatever reason, fast, quick, whatever, they lose their identity. They lose their self-confidence. They lose what they feel their value is, because their value is tied to the title and what they did. And, you know, part of everything that I did on a regular basis was teaching them how to go out and look for a job. You can't just go to a job board and do that. But the biggest thing that I saw immediately was I have to teach people how to believe in themselves again, how to teach people that just because you lost your title and your job doesn't mean you lost your value. You still have all this value, but how do you take what you have and figure out how it fits other places? And so it's not just, you know, when Michael reached out to me and he's like, you know, I want to do this. You know, this is my experience from when I got out of the Globetrotters. And I'm like, that's really the same thing that I have experience with and myself personally. And I said, I think this is a great opportunity because the public loves to hear sports stories. Okay. And the athletes, and there's so many regular guys, they're not all Steph Curry's. You know, they all don't have this, you know, 50 million year career and make billions of dollars. Everyday people going through all of this. And so that is why we decided to do the podcast and talk about this, because we feel it's relevant to everybody. You know, it's just like when you were talking about being with the Phoenix Suns, you know, you go to a new company, whatever it is, and there's always someone that may be trying to take your job or your position, or, you know, jealous of you or are looking out for you. So it's all about that. But this has been a fantastic story that you've shared. And, you know, it's interesting, we've done, you're going to be like, I think the 17th or 18th episode. No one's story has been the same. No one's.
I got a question. This is the question I always like to ask. I really wanted Sandy to get the point in. Thank you so much, Sandy, for doing that. I wanted to let out my brother Ashley know that he's not alone. And no. So many people go through that. But if you can go back to that little kid on that horse farm, you can go back right now and you just started playing basketball, what would you tell Al? What would you tell a young Alvin Sims?
This, you know, be prepared for the end. You know, you can reach a goal, but if the goal is not sustainable, then just be prepared to divert and adjust.
Very true. Wow. How old were you when you got injured?
36.
And how long did it take you to rehabilitate after? What was that injury again?
It was a Jones fracture in my right foot. The same injury Yao Ming had when he had to retire.
Oh.
And so, then, I know Yao Ming said, but that the way you played, that affected every aspect of your game. That foot injury, because how you played, because you were so explosive. I can only imagine what, you know, like, man, I would kill this guy, but I can't, you know, my foot is not right. You know what I mean? I know the feeling. I do. Like, man, I would have blocked that shot, but I can't. My knee or my foot. Usually at a certain age, I couldn't disrespect the game anymore. I couldn't play the way I normally played. You know, I was always going to pull some or trying to do something that I used to could do. You know, mentally, I was still there, but my body was like, nah, you can't do it anymore. You know what I mean? And just getting in shape was a little bit more harder than it was when you were, as you get older.
Yeah.
I thought I was Superman, but I found out Father Time is undefeated.
Mike, got any other questions?
No, I mean, you said, I know what you want to go into it, man. You said you were good right now where you're at. You know, yeah. You're good right now. You know, Iowa, is that the place? Is that it?
Yeah, until I retire. Yeah, but, you know, I'm here. I love it. You know, my life is here. So, yeah.
That's beautiful, man. Hey, I really want to thank you, man, for your time, for being on the show. Like I said, I know your schedule is busy. I'm surprised, especially on the weekend, as much stuff as you coach.
Yeah.
You were able to give us an hour of your time. I'm surprised, man. My college coach used to, you know, as high as you could jump, my college coach used to always try to push me to play volleyball. Did they ever push you to try to play volleyball as well?
Nah, I don't even know if we – yeah, we did have a men's volleyball team, but they wasn't as good as the girls, so nah.
Actually, that's right. I don't think I've seen a lot of men's volleyball teams except like on television for the Olympics. That's interesting. Oh. I just now thought about that. Okay. As we come to the end of this episode of the Fifth Quarter Podcast, we want to remind everyone out there to give us a follow on Apple, Spotify, and subscribe on our YouTube channel. If you're interested in becoming a sponsor for our show, you can contact us through our website. And if you're feeling really inspired, we love a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. We love hearing the feedback from everyone. And those reviews actually help us get more listeners and help people find our show.
All right. Thank you, guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Alvin. Thank you so much for being on the show today.
No problem. I enjoyed it.
Great. Thank you for joining us on this episode of the Fifth Quarter Podcast with our guest, Alvin Sims. Until next time, remember, change is our ally and it paves the way for greatness. Stay inspired. Have a great rest of the week.
So much wisdom, Sandy.